and understanding. Explanation as far as how we get to where we are. Before we go into the presentation, I'd just like to introduce some of the members that support here. There are some building committee members who are in the back of the room. Michael Chill Kelly, Janet Lomo, Steve Carroll, and Millie Manley. As far as I support, we do have a lot of information that architects and Steve Millen. And Jim Boyd, who is currently the Franklin School Principal, he will be the Woodville School Principal, opens up.
Just introduce yourself,
Dave. I'm sorry?
Introduce yourself.
Of course, my name is David Bryson, the chairman of the school building. A little bit of history, we have been working on this project, and actually the Dilbury School since for the last 3 years. The Dilbury School, of course, is now completed. We are now focusing on the Woodville School. The original design was submitted to the Department of Education in 1997 in order to get on the grant list. That project basically sat on a shelf for 3 years while we worked on the building. The Dilbury School was not completed, and we started to focus on the Woodville School. So first, one of the first things we did, just a brief history in the last few months, we quickly pulled the drawings off the shelf, started looking at the drawings, started looking at the design. Started meeting with the teachers from the Dilbury School, and Jim Boyd was instrumental in meeting with the teachers from the Franklin School, and the Franklin teachers over the Dilbury, and walked around the school, and tell us what they think works, what doesn't work, how they know the classroom, colors, and everything. We found out that we got a lot of great comments back from the teachers and the staff. And we also had various subcommittee meetings where we met with Jim Boyd, and we looked at the design of the building. From that, we started finding ways that we can improve the design of the building from a functional point of view. And one example was the previous design of the reading rooms on the first floor. The reading room was serving mostly the upper grades. But the first floor had the kindergarten classes, so the only thing we did is we shifted the reading room up to the upper levels. So we had many design modifications that we presented to each of the architects. At the same time, in April, we had to get a cost estimate to find out where we were as far as our budget. And unfortunately, back then the budget in April came out, I don't remember the exact number, I think it was around $11.8 million. Our original budget for construction was 7.2, so there was a difference. We did have some money in contingency, we were hoping to have come in around $10 million, but we were clearly over budget. So we had to start providing engineering exercise to find ways to reduce the cost of the building without affecting education of how to build. So we started that exercise. And one of the things we looked at, for instance, is on the original design, there's some very nice curved metal roofs in the gym and over the market, but they're very expensive. And we're trying to fit the budget, so we had to sacrifice that. But at the same time, we didn't really sacrifice any of the classroom spaces. Another object that was added is since 1997, and this is working with 2020, we didn't have to add space. We had a one kindergarten class and a couple of the state mandated spaces, such as a behavioral special needs classroom and a student set hall. So we made the building smaller, entirely new cost. We made the building simpler. We made the building more compact, more usable. But we also had an educational space. We did get a cost estimate done recently. It's still over budget. Not as bad as that, but approximately $1.5 million over the budget. So at this point, we've done our exercise, and you know, this is the best way we're going to talk to any of us paying for that $1.5 million. I think afterwards, if there are specific questions on that, I'll just answer them. But for now, I'm going to turn the presentation over to Steve Miller.
Thank you all for being here. We brought to tonight the efforts of our 6 months of work that we've done. Taking the 1997 submission to the state for funding approval, modifying it, as David mentioned, in a number of ways, adding some educational programs to it, moving some educational programs around. I'll go through the plan and explain to you how all got more educational square footage in here than we have in 97 within the state overall gross. So we've done a number of things to simplify it. This is the street out front here. Out of the rain all the way.
all the issues that need to be resolved. We're still in the data discussion, but I have that information. If there are items that are long term to be made improvement, we will certainly bring that up and actually start looking towards the board of selectmen to assist us in making improvements to the street that are more to do with the high school population and commuters passing through.
Was that report we shared with the board?
Yes, actually at some point we could have a separate meeting that we could have as a part of our regular meeting. Perhaps we can discuss it then, and you can open it up as a subcommittee meeting with the others. I've also put Jamie Floyd on the spot before, and this also goes to the PTO, where we really like to get the PTO involved in working with Jim on a traffic. Traffic migration plan, some sense of how parents are going to come in and drop off their kids and get a system going, get a design, get a plan, this is what I'm trying to say, before the cycling seal there is actually presented to the board of appeals. This time, we want to make sure that the cycling works for Jim's traffic plan before they actually start putting down the pavement. So those are very important questions. I really don't have any answers because we just started that.
I guess to touch on that question that the gentleman had, when this building was used at its full capacity, how many students were in this building? And was parking, was traffic a problem then? If people are expressing concerns about traffic now about the new school, I mean, obviously this is a pretty big school and it must have had a full-size student body in here when it was working to its full capacity. Were there problems then when it was working to its maximum capacity?
Can I address that?
Yes.
My children went to school here in elementary before it was closed. There was a small population here. There was only like five grades. There was one kindergarten, one first grade, one second grade, and so forth. No, there wasn't a traffic problem. But that's only about 100 children. Now, you're going to get 500 children. That's a lot of cars. It's a lot of students, a lot of buses. And the fact that you only have one street, God forbid something should happen, these kids can't get out because you're only going down here or there. The high school has Nahan Street, has Oak Street. This school only has Nahan Street. You can't go down Kennedy Circle. It's a dead end. You can't go down Woodville Circle. That's a dead end. So you're talking about less than 100 children in this school years ago opposed to 500-something children in this school. But the Dalby School is two main streets.
Yes.
This isn't. Well, I think you have a problem.
How has that shaken out? It's
an ongoing issue, Michael, from Kelly. Was there a school council meeting here recently where they were still working on it a little bit? It's an issue now.
Yeah, but we have the high, we have the high school, we have the Vogue School, we'll have 500 students at this.
So do we have the crack jobs now?
I live right across the street, and I can't get out in the morning. It's humanly impossible to get out when high school already. And if you come here, park your car in Kennedy Circle at 1:30 and watch the traffic from 1:30 to about a quarter past 2:30. It's constant. I know, but you have the high school, you have the Vogue School, and now you're going to have an elementary. You're going to cause a traffic jam for about 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours in the afternoon. You live off in the, you live off of Farm Street. You don't live right there.
But I mean, all this travel is going to get our children to school now. It's not as well as they are, so you can take a bus to get Franklin.
But Franklin is one school. I'm talking about three schools.
Well, we had 200 and some students then.
You're going to have 500 students then.
I'd like to get our story. I know traffic is such a big issue. It's perhaps as a separate meeting, staff meeting with the PTO and Jim Roy and staff really talking about traffic. At the same time, in another month or so, we'll have the traffic study, which will pinpoint exactly what's, if there is anything wrong with Park Street now that needs to be addressed. Even prior to the school being built, these issues will be brought up so that the result prior to the school even being built.
Do you need to talk about this continuing?
This is going to be 2,000% better than Franklin School. Our children getting out of the car that's been raining the snow and walking into school. I mean, it is an emotional thing. So, I mean, this is going to be light years ahead of that. Like that's
the other thing, too, is we're hoping that the school will be opened up in the year 2001. So there is at least a 2002. So that it is at least another 2 years to start to really work on traffic. And ideally, the first day of school should be no traffic as we thought about for the last 2 years. And that's really a challenge, I think, to the building committee, to the PTL, to Jim Boyd, and the neighbors as well. That first day of school, everything runs smoothly. Maybe mine.
She has a solution, make them walk. You can't walk to school like me.
That's a very interesting
thing.
That's right.
Yes. There is an issue about high school department too, which the school committee and the school department, not going to be able to.
They're not going to be able to not hunt. Farm Street either. They're going to go all the way up.
There's nothing wrong with that.
With what?
With that not being able to park on Farm Street, you might think.
Well, they shouldn't have been parking there all along.
I don't see the need to park there.
Question again?
Yes, I live on Farm Street.
Yes.
And I cannot get out to get to work in the morning without a 20-minute wait. And as far as the kids getting out of school, if I'm coming home at that time, they're blocking the driveway. I can't get into my driveway, my own driveway.
There's clearly a problem with the high school park. There's clearly a problem with Farm Street now. And those issues will be addressed by the traffic study is done with those issues out.
I've been hit twice.
So you're telling me the traffic that stands in every morning, no cars moving, pulling it up. So when I come down strong, my video camera, I can catch some video every day, that the cars are then moving, it's not normal traffic, everybody's going to see it, it's 2 hours every day, I know that every day. What is the case? Is it moving traffic or not?
It isn't moving that much, no.
Hey, if I can move on to the other.
the same requirements, like they have to go for something similar variance.
There's a whole history with the Dollar School and zoning. We had to complete the, obviously not the height, but we did have the same restrictions for the driveway width. We had the same restrictions for parking in front of the building. But those are two main ones, which we went to the city special permit. We went through a long process, a 4-month process, and we got the traffic report. We had all this information to win the hearings, and essentially, we were not ready to zone the lead. Since we're not ready to zone the lead, we had to make a 20-foot-long driveway with no legal parking in front of the building. We had to shift all the parking to the side of the building, and that's why it's no longer alternate there. So, in that particular case, we were able to come up with an alternate site plan without the zoning complete. In this particular case, without the zoning complete, we've got the square.
Who's going to vote on this? Who's the person that will decide what board?
That's the board of appeals. Let's say they can read the forms. Let me approach them. What, this school? In the original town meeting article, even though the $12.7 million was approved, we were, as a building committee, allowed to spend up to $590,000 in design. Design had to name the architects to go in front of various boards to develop approvals. One thing we could not do until the town sells the funds, to release the funds, is to go for construction. That is contingent on the town receiving the reimbursement from the builders, which we just found out. They expect to receive checks at the end of this month. So now that the town starts receiving checks for the builders for this board of selectmen can now sell bonds for the funding for the Lucas school. So to answer your question, we have, based on the town meeting article, we have met all of our needs. All the needs of the town meeting article.
So you're speaking about receiving the construction and some pieces within the meeting, which we're going to do for the demolition?
Yes, and also to expedite what we're thinking about, we're still discussing in the community, is whether or not to have this building torn down prior to the start.
In order to get a longer construction period for this building, make sure we get in on the September 2015 date, which was closing. Closing to tear down this building early next year, January, February. So the site will be ready for the new contract when this fee comes up.
Is this building
made by the
variances? And if we tear it down, is that
destroyed? This building, we actually went from the Historical Commission. The Historical Commission doing their job, they actually voted that this building that we're sitting at is a preferably I'm not sure the exact language, but essentially they told me that this building should remain intact. So that kicked in a 6-month demolition delay waiting period, which I think is due to expire in December. At the end of 6 months, if the town has not found another need for this building that is feasible, then the building inspector has to issue the demolition permit. There's just, I don't know how else this is, but to say it's not functionally highly computed.
Okay.
It's just, you can see the size of the building. It costs less to just take it all off.
One question.
Why are we putting it in the construction numbers and the project cost?
25, they go to the building, hey, it's a big deal. It's 30 or 50 years. You know, let's look right here.
Okay. You can see there is a long driveway there. Lots of room to queue on cars, look at the door, have the child pick out the car, and the parent moves between the cars and the house, just to get the parent, get the car off the driveway, get the kid out of the car.
But I mean, if it's in front of the buses, not the parents can drive to the end of the runway and drop off the kid and say, see us. It ain't gonna happen.
To answer the question about the budget, $12.7 million is the overall budget that was approved. In that time, we are going to have that 12.7, I believe, $7.8 million was set aside for construction costs. So the difference between those numbers is everything else that they did architects do. Frankly, there's so many other things that are part of that budget. The 7.2 is construction costs, and 11.3 is still construction costs. Those other items in that total budget have shifted. We've shifted some dollar values, some numbers that are not, so we can try to sort of ask for the least amount of money as possible. But overall, we have all the numbers together because of the started having conversations with the Attorney General, Superintendent of Schools. We started having conversations with the people in the Department of Education. It became apparent that instead of 2003, we would receive our reimbursement from Woodville 2001. So, no, from Woodville. We received, I'm sorry, 2002. So, it worked out that we were getting our funding 1 year, 2 years sooner. So, if we're getting our funding sooner, plus there's an obvious need for this school, we're trying to take advantage of it. And then the other thing is that you can see how much this building has cost just in 3 years. If we build the school 1 year sooner, it will cost that much less construction.
Change to the
I used to work for the school of the building. So we really feel that we might be challenged to make the building better than the original design. Unfortunately, we do have to go back for additional money. But at this point, I don't see what else, the committee doesn't know what else to do. We can start locking out classrooms and we're not going to form this 300. That really doesn't fit with the policy that the school committee is trying to set for the town. So just in closing, I encourage everybody to attend town meeting, regardless of their view of the school. And I look forward to a good discussion. Yes, sir.
Am I correct in assuming that buses and parents will drop the kids off?